Welcome again to this edition, Know Your Church, at Our Lady of Africa Church, Mbuya Parish. And this is a new month, happy June. And as we all know, every June 3rd, we celebrate the Uganda Martyrs of Uganda. But this time it's lockdown, and well, we have to celebrate it in our homes. And today it's a special edition. We're going to know more about Gildo Ira and Daudi Okello. These are the Komboni missionary saints of Uganda that were killed and martyred in the northern part of Uganda. But all that is going to be known to us through our guest today, who is Father Larem, as we all know him. But his name is Father Giuseppe Claridge. Father, welcome to this edition.
I am very happy to be with you and to speak about the fruit of our evangelization in the north of Uganda.
Yes. So, Father, you've been in Uganda for more than 50 years.
Yes.
And can you share with us your story, mostly if you've worked in the northern part of Uganda? How was life in your times?
You know, the one thing I want to tell you is this. My vocation is due to the Uganda martyrs. When I was very young, 9 and a half years old, a Komboni mission was coming with the train in my parish to help my parish priest. And he was, of course, I was an altar boy, and one day he called us and he showed us the slides. There was no film at that time, slides of the Uganda martyrs. And I was impressed by San Kizito. Very time when I was a professor, I went to study philosophy. So we started to learn a bit of English. So what happened? A certain moment came to visit us from Mexico a father, Komboni, who was there in the town of Sahuayo, where in 1936 there was a great persecution against the Catholics. So he's listening this story. I said, no, Uganda martyrs, I leave. I want to go to Mexico. This was because the Spanish is much more near to the Italian, to the Latin. But what happened? When I became priest, I was sent to a minor seminary. But after 1 year of staying with this young seminarian, no, I was dismissed because they said, you are not able to keep the discipline among these children. So, okay, we are going to change your commitment in the community. But they said, no, send me to the mission. But the provincial superior said, no, you are sick. I answered, I have not been so healthy as I was now, as I am now. So the thing stopped there. After a week, I received a destination to Uganda. Previous, a small period of time in England, just to learn a bit of English. That was the happiest day of my life. So I was connecting all these things, you see. How my vocation was started, how it's going to be implemented by the power of God, of course. When I was in England to study English, on Mission Sunday, there was a canonization of Uganda martyrs. And I went to the Westminster Cathedral, and the celebration, the great celebration, was animated by the student, by the scholastic theologian, or the white fathers. They were beating the drum and so on, no? So I was very happy. So I went to Rome, I dressed in white cassock, and one of the fathers, the Komboni, who was there, he gave me the relics of the Uganda martyrs. So you see how God is planning in our lives. So I came to Uganda, I was sent to Kitgum to learn the Acholi. After 6 months, I was sent to Opit. I left Opit, I went to the Cathedral of Gulu for 2 years. And it already went in 1970, I went to Italy for the first time after 5 years. Difficult was this, when I was sent to a pit, half of the parish, they were speaking Lango. But I learned Acholi. They are very similar, but I was confused completely. But being in charge of this movement, Crusaders, I started to learn, I was forced to learn. I know Acholi better than English, especially when the bishop in 1970 came back from my holidays, he sent me to Madio Pei. During the time I was in Madio Pei, there was a first synod of the Ogulu Diocese. The Comboni missionary arrived to Uganda, not as the white fathers from the lake, from Tanzania, but they came back from South Sudan. South Sudan. In 1911, the Comboni missionary were in Sudan, in South Sudan, much earlier, 1886 and so on, even before. But in Uganda, they arrived in 1911. The first mission was not in Gulu, was in the Omach. Omach was near the Nile, among the Alur. But later on, due to the mosquitoes, malaria and so on, so they transferred from there to Angal. And the group went to Gulu. And later on, they went to Kitgum. I don't know exactly the year, but in 1913, they reached Kitgum, and they started. When the parish priest, the one in charge of that era, was Father Cesar Gambaretto. And among the first group of the catechumens, he had Daudio Kelo and Gildo Irua. After 2 years of catechumen in the mission, they were baptized. They say another year, they received the confirmation. After the confirmation, say the British, they changed the chief of Paimol of that area because he was not supporting their politics. They appointed another one was more in favor of the British. The old chief, he ran to Sudan and to nearby Ethiopia. They organized a revolution. After they were confirmed, these two catechists, these two young Christians, Daudi and Gildo, they asked the parish priest, Father Gambaretto Caesar, to go there and to substitute the old catechist who was dead, who died. The father was reluctant, because you are too young, and the situation there is very tense. But these two young Christians said, no, we don't go there for the British. We go there for Jesus Christ, to tell the good news to those people. But the father replied them, but if they will kill you, no, don't mind. We go to heaven to see Mary and Jesus. So the father gave them a rosary and a book of catechism. These are the two things they went with. And they stayed in Paimol. At the beginning it was very easy because the one in charge of the air, the chief of the air, he gave them two heads where they were sleeping. They were gathering especially young people for the catechism. At a certain moment, the head catechist of Kigum came in that area, no? And he was hearing the rumors that Abash, they call Abash, this rebel, they were coming, they were near to come. So The catechist, he went there to report this to the audiovisual to leave, because they were in danger to be killed. But they refused. They don't want to leave. After a few days, early morning, this Apache, they reached the area. First to be killed was Daoud Yokel, because he was much older than Gildon. And Gildon, they want to spare him because he was too young, he was about 13, 14 years old. But he said, no, you have killed my brother, you kill me too, because I want to go to heaven with him. So they kill him. Daoud Yokel, he was buried in the Antwine Hill. He was put in there, the body. I don't know how they did. And instead, Gildo was very young, he was left like this. Probably during night time, the wild beasts, they were coming, they were eating everything. The fame of their holiness, of their martyrdom, it was very alive among the people. Very much alive. In 1926, the vicar apostolic, Monsignor Antonio Vignato, he was not a bishop, he was a vicar apostolic, hearing this kind of fame of holiness, of martyrdom of these two, he went to Paimol and he collected the remain of Daoud Yokel. And he took them to Kid Gum Parish. They were buried. They were buried in near the sanctuary of the church. But later on, because the church was covered with grass at that time. Later on, the brother, I don't remember the date. They renewed the church. They put the iron sheets and so on and so on. So this remain of Daoud Yokel, they were taken from there. They were put in a box, lead box, and they were buried in the chapel nearby the left door, the entrance or left door of the chapel. And there were some writing again around the chapel, and in front there was a picture of their martyrdom. People, they were spearing them. Yeah. Now, in 1950, Father Albertini was a theologian, he studied in Rome. So, he was coming from Verona. So he went to greet the retired vicar apostolic, Monsignor Vignato. And Monsignor Vignato told him, please go down during the holidays. I give you a commitment to make a research about the martyrdom of these two young catechists. So he came during the holidays. The father from Gulu, Lachor Seminary, Major Lachor Seminary, he was going to Kigum, the era of Kigum. And he wrote a famous malloppo, more than 500 pages, all typed, with the old typewriter. And this malloppo, this collection of witnesses, was sent to Rome to one of the lawyers of the cause of canonization. And he was sent back with some correction. But later on, with the new bishop Cesana, the cause was a bit, it was kept in the archives. It was not so much interest. When I was in Bagliopei, it was the first synod of Gulu. The parish priest and a group of Christians of Kalongo, because Paimol was under Kalongo parish, they brought the motion, let us restart this cause of beatification and canonization. So all the Comboni Fathers and the few Acholi priests, they seconded it. So especially at that time there was a Pere Spirito Calongo and another father, Father Marchetti, who was a very, was one who studied in Rome. He had a lot of knowledge of the Vatican and so on. He was working very much, especially to collect the witnesses, you know, that at that time they were still alive. But, you see, what was more important was to look for the Malloppo of Father Albertini. The Comboni missionary in Rome, they accepted to start the cause. But what happened? This Malloppo was, they could not find it. They went several times to the archives of the Archbishop of Guru, Odama. But what happened? They were not able, because the archive was in disorder during the insurgency of the wars. No? They could not, was in disorder. So the father were very, very sorry. But I don't remember the year, but on the Boxing Day of Christmas, they went there again. At the last moment, they found in a corner the Malloppo, wrapped in the wasted paper. So this was practically the conclusion of the court, because everything was sent to Rome. And fortunately, in Rome we had a father, very clever father, Father Barituzio, it's called Barituzio. He's in charge of this course of beatifications. After 2 years, now, at that time, I was in Laibi, and I had a computer, the first computer among the Comboni. The internet reached there in Google, the MTN. But you see, the signal was very poor. But this Father Marchetti, every year was coming to me, let us hear some news about these two martyrs. No. The Father Marchetti was very clever. He knew a lot of cardinals. So when the positio super martyrium, positio is the proof of the martyrdom of these two young catechists, was ready, not very huge. Eh? We have a copy here in our archive of the provision. When it was ready, Father Marchetti, very clever and very cunning, what he did. He wrote a letter signed by the, or a letter written by him, but directed to the Pope John Paul II, signed by the Archbishop Odama, the present Archbishop of Guru. And this letter he gave to Archbishop. He was going to Rome for a synod. And he said, "My dear Bishop, go there. When the Holy Father will come along the St. Peter, you give him this letter to him personally." The letter practically was asking the Pope St. Paul John II to have a private audience. So, after a few days, the Pope called the Comboni in Rome. He said, "Please, the Holy Father accepted the private audience for the Archbishop of Guru." So Father Barituzzi, the promoter of the cause of beatification, he went with the Archbishop to the Vatican with one copy of the proof of their martyrdom. So they went there. When they reached the private study of John Paul II, the Father Barituzzi or stop. He said, no, it's a private audience. Only the Archbishop is allowed to enter. But the Archbishop said, no, this is my private secretary. He must come with me. I cannot stay without him. So they entered, both of them. So the Archbishop, after greeting the Pope, you know, he started to talk about this. At a certain moment, the Pope asked the Archbishop, Archbishop, Dama, these two martyrs, were they local? Are they Africans? Are they local? And the Bishop said, yes, they are local. The Pope said, give me the position, give me the proof. He wrote on the first page, cause very urgent to be examined as soon as possible. So they went. On the day of, the following day, the Bishop came back to Uganda, but the promoter of the cause of beatification, Father Bertucci, was called by the Congregation of the Saints. He said, why did you jump us? Why did you go straight to the Vatican? But the Father said, I don't know, because I was not the one who jumped you. The Archbishop asked the Pope for a private audience. So at the beginning, this priest, no, this Monsignore, was very tough with Father Bertuccio. Eh? But don't you remember that your cause was a deposition of 274? I said, I don't know. This was the Archbishop of Gun. Now, we were in October. After becoming a bit more quiet, this Monsignore, he said, okay, Father, bring me as soon as possible 10 copies of the proof of their martyrdom. I will distribute them to the one in charge and let them examine the cause if they were really martyr. He said, after Easter, I will call them back. So, over 10, 7 came back to report. 5 of them, 7, 6 of them, they reported. 5 of them, they were in favor. They are real martyrs of the faith. One was an advocate of the devil. He said, no. They committed a sin of imprudence. They had to run away. But all the group, they said, what a stupid reason is given. It is so clear that they are martyrs. This was in after Easter. A certain moment, usually, when they approve their martyrdom or the heroic virtue, usually those interested, they ask the Pope, when do you want to be beatified? Instead, for these two martyrs, the Pope John Paul II, through the secretary, he called the Comboni in Rome, said, I want to beatify this martyr of Uganda on the mission Sunday. So this is how the cause of beatification was concluded, the first steps. Eh? Now, we are waiting for a miracle, but the miracles are already there. The only thing that they are very, how do you say, very meticulous in approving this, in accepting the miracle. Now, what I want to go back now a bit, because when I started to be involved in this cause of beatification, I went to Kigum to check in the first baptisms register. In the first page, among the first baptized by Father Deleta Gambaretto, I found Dawoodi Okello and Gilles de Rouen. Not only, but in the left side, where there is notifications, the father Gambaretto was still alive. He wrote at that time, Interfecti profide. This in Latin, let me translate. Martyred for the faith. My dear, for me, I am a bit proud to have worked among the Acholi. That sometimes you see, okay, they are very good, but about faith, I tell you, they were like a baganda, because to have a martyr is not a simple thing. It's a very great gift from God. And for me, the martyr of Paimon, I am so much attached.
So, Father, does your attachment come because you were part of the beatification process for them?
Yes, I was a part. I did not done the special studies, but at that time, you see, we already need some members. So I was the one chosen. So I was very proud. I work a lot, even I succeed in having some relics of this martyrdom, and so I was very happy, I tell you.
Well, thank you so much, Father Giuseppe Clerici.
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 Clerici, la rem.
La rem. Oh, yes. I'll have to cram that for some time. I'll get it right. I promise you, Father. Now, dear viewers, we've had the whole history of how the saints Gildo Iwa and Dawoodi Okello came to be martyred in Paimon. And of course, Father has taken us through the entire journey step by step. And I'm sure, just like I am, you've really grasped the whole history and you've seen it like a movie. And well, just to remind you that Dawoodi Okello and Gildo Iwa took over the catechism from catechist Antonio. He was called Antonio,
no,
who died.
No, they were taught by Cesare Gambaretto. But the apostolic vicar who was believing since the beginning of this master was Monsignor Antonio Vignato.
Antonio Vignato. We need to get the real pronunciation of such names. But just so you know, Dawoodi Okello was between 10 to 12 years, and Gildo Iwa was 14, between 14 to 16.
But I know that, you know, at that time the age was very difficult to be, yes, to be, how do you say, state clearly. But Gildo was very young. Very young. The Okello Dawoodi was a bit older, maybe 16, 17. There is another particular. When we went to Guru, I was present in his exhumation. I went there with Father Marchetti. He was the secretary of Marchetti, Meister.
Wow.
I had to obey him. Eh? Oh. When we went there, it was very difficult to find the place of their burial, where they were kept. There was a brother still alive, I was in Milan, a bit out. They become in age, you see, the memory become rusty. So many times, Father Marchetti, the procurator of Guru, no, about the beatification, he contacted him, I said, I don't remember. But when we were there, trying to look for where they were buried, were kept, a father there was already in paradise, Father Pazzaglia, he called Milan and said, please, Superior, ask Father, the brother who is there with you, was the one who buried the remain of this martyr. And tell him, ask him, where did he bury them? Where did he put them? He said, on the floor. So a brother was there, he was knocking the wall, but there was nothing. When he started to, I don't know what they use, he started that underground, it was a void. So they removed the cement and they found this box sealed, lead. The lead is very protective, yeah? Cannot get rotten. So they open, and of course, in this kind of control, they call some doctors, two doctors, were in Kigum St. Joseph Hospital. And they examine the skull of Okelo. And they said that the skull is of a young man, not yet mature. He mean that he was of that age. The mature become rather 20, 21, you know. So what we did, we put all this remain in a very nice box, and we brought it back to Gulu, and it's still there under the altar of the chapel of the bishop, of the Archbishop of Dama.
Wow. So where we have it, there were two young catechists, not yet 18, because they were all not yet mature. Now we look at how they were killed.
They were both of them speared.
Both of them were speared.
They were speared. At the time there was no gun yet. The gun was very few. And they were so they came to the British.
So they were both speared.
Yes.
Dowd Okello was buried in an anthill.
And yes.
Gildo was left.
Left there.
By the bats.
Yes.
Okay, dear viewers, as we come to a conclusion, there are many young men, young boys out there who love to be part of the religious dialect, religious sectors. Father, what lesson are we supposed to get from these young catechists? They were all under 18. They were so brave enough to face death for their Christ. What lessons do we draw from them?
The message is this. To be Christian Catholics does not mean to be baptized, to be confirmed. But this is the, how do you say, is the new birth, no? In water and spirit, no? But this is the, what's that? You must grow in your spiritual life. And you grow with the faith, with prayer, with the rosary. So you become really, how do you say, a great witness. We can be witnesses of our faith. It's not necessary to be baptized with anything, but you must practice, especially to observe the commandments of God, but to love everybody, because the love is, how do you say, the great gift that God has given us. Love which consists especially in forgiving, respect, praying for your persecute for those who are disturbing you. And don't forget that the prayer that this young catechist, they went with, was the rosary. And for me, the rosary is the prayer to Mary, so that she may help us to meditate and to relieve the mystery of the rosary, no? The joyful mystery, the mystery of light. We relive the life of Jesus. And Mary, the mission of Mary, Our Lady of Africa, is this, to take us not to herself, but to take us to Jesus. Is the mother of Jesus and our mother. And don't forget, Mary is not an optional. It's not an option in our devotions. No, absolutely.
And to conclude, just to echo the lessons we've learned from Gildo Ivan Dowd Okello, prayer, and of course, when you look at their history, Dowd Okello used to start his instructions or catechist classes with rosary. And then love, forgive your persecutors, and respect.
First of all, I'm grateful for the opportunity to share something about these ancestors in faith. And above all, to also be inspired by the martyrs who were mainly youth. When we speak about Daudi Okello and Jiro Irwa, the martyrs from Paimol, we also contemplate what God has been doing through his missionaries. The two young catechists, would say, were initiated into faith by the Kombon missionaries. That makes me very proud also to belong to a missionary congregation that can count some fruits. But then they volunteered to go and bring faith in that part of the Acholi land where we now speak about Paimol, and it was their conviction to share the faith with the others that maybe brought them into conflict with the people who didn't embrace Christianity at the beginning. That young catechists, I would say youth, were ready to share their faith. It is both a gift but also a challenge. The first time I reached Wipolo, would say Paimol, I was really touched by these two young martyrs who were ready to give their lives for Christ. For me, they are a gift to say that it is possible at any age to be a witness of Jesus Christ. They are also a challenge because being a witness of the gospel and a witness of Jesus' truth needs a lot of courage and a sacrifice. That is what challenges me, and I ask myself, if today I am put in front of a challenge that really questions my faith, will I be able to be convicted as a martyr? This is a question really that accompanies me, and when I made a pilgrimage to Paimol, I kept on asking myself, is my faith strong enough that I am ready to die for it? And as a young man, I would say, it doesn't matter. I'm not very young, as people would think, but I'll say, doesn't matter the age, it's not so important. If one is convinced that has roots in Christ, that is enough to give, to share what a person has learned.
Remember to follow us on our Facebook, YouTube and Twitter channels, Our Lady of Africa Church in Buya, and do leave your comments as well so that we can always engage and interact. Thank you so much for being with us. I'm Joan Banura. See ya.